Good morning. And welcome back on this beautiful fall morning. It's good to see everyone here. I'm going to dive right in because we got a busy week coming up. That begins today at 11:30. Mount Hermon Baptist Church is having their fried chicken luncheon today beginning at 11:30. That's at the Goode Root Rescue Squad there next to the post office. $15 a person or $10 for those 12 and under, I believe it is. All are invited to attend. And then this afternoon at 5, we have our council meeting. All are invited to attend that also. Tomorrow at 10, we have an M&M's meeting.
Yes.
Anne, you want to fill us in?
I want to fill you in. Tomorrow at 10 o'clock, Missions and More will meet, and our guest speaker is going to be Margaret Crawley. She is with Salem Global Methodist Church, and they go on mission trips all right, mainly in southern states, North Carolina, South Carolina, Tennessee, when there's been a natural disaster. They'll probably be going on one very soon. Our original speaker was going to be the pastor of Salem Global Methodist Church, but he's having some health issues right now. So Margaret will be here with us. So I hope you can be here tomorrow at 10 o'clock and welcome Margaret as she tells us more about their mission trips. Thank you.
Thank you.
At CW,
mm-hmm.
I want to remind everybody we have Trunk or Treat coming up October 27th, so bring your candy, bring your kids, decorate your cars, decorate yourselves, October 27th, right after church.
Okay, looking forward to that. Everybody really enjoys that. Tuesday, 10 a.m., Bible studies here at Bethany, and 7 p.m. at Oakland. Wednesday, chair aerobics at 10 a.m. and our community prayer service from 7 to 7:30 at Oakland. Thursday, we will resume volunteering at Gleaning for the World from 1:30 to 3:30. And if you want, we will be carpooling here, meet at 12:45 here at church to get together for that. And then Friday, chair aerobics once again from at 10 o'clock. And Saturday, well, we'll give you a day of rest. You can catch your breath now. Anything else coming up? Any other announcements?
See, Deb, you remind them about the fundraiser.
Oh, yes, yes. You know, at the concert and ice cream social, we had a little offering there for the hurricane relief. So far, we have collected $875. But if you would like, still plenty of time. Just if you want to make her a check, just drop it in the offering plate there and we'll earmark it for hurricane relief. We haven't decided where we're going to send it yet, but there are plenty of places that are volunteering and all, and there's a lot of work to be done so they can use all the money and help they can get. Okay, thank you, Phil. Is there anything else? Okay, thank you.
Spirit of the Lord.
Our invocation this morning is prayer to the Holy Spirit found there on the screen. Please stand and let's join together. Let us pray. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful and kindle in us the fire of your love. Send forth your Spirit and we shall be created, and you shall renew the face of the earth. O God, who by the light of the Holy Spirit did instruct the hearts of the faithful, grant that by the same Holy Spirit we may be truly wise and ever ensure your consolations. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. And if you will, please turn to page 64 and let's join together in Holy, Holy Lord God Almighty.
Good morning, and welcome to our worship on this beautiful Sunday. Folks, I wish y'all could seen the church yesterday, how beautifully it was decorated. You can see some of the flowers here and as you walked in, but oh, it was gorgeous in the fellowship hall, everything.
Thank y'all for letting us do that.
All glad to it. You're good.
We'll throw it away if you find something that doesn't
belong. Exactly.
If anybody would like some flowers on their way out, please feel free.
Yes. Well, I must say the most beautiful sight, though, was the bride and groom. It really was a beautiful service. So I was honored to help with it. Even if I did make a couple mistakes, but we won't go there. It came off with a hitch. That's the main thing. What other joys and concerns do we have to share this morning?
my friend, she's a friend of a lot of us in here.
Yeah.
Lois and me, Betty Miller, who lives in Naples, Florida. Of course, she had to evacuate.
Yeah.
And she had a hotel to go to. They called her and said that hotel had to evacuate. But anyway, so she went to some friends of hers down there for a while. So she got back to her house, and the power was on, no air conditioning. And then all the power was off. They told her it would come on for Wednesday, but it's back on.
Good.
And so a few of the houses in her little pod that she lives in got some water damage, but she didn't get any. So
praise the Lord.
God was looking after Betty.
Amen. Amen. Anyone else? Well, we want to keep Reverend Chuck Schooler in our prayers. I mean, I know he's disappointed he couldn't come. He really is, because he loves to talk about the mission work they do at Salem. So we'll add Chuck to the prayer list. Our prayers for Shirley Tinsley were answered. Some of y'all might have been following where they were able to remove the polyp, and they got word back, no cancer. So she can rejoice and relax, and maybe that'll help Lloyd's blood pressure a little bit, because he had to go to the ER Tuesday night, but everything went well with that, so we praise God for that. And Lois Breeding has a new room now. I put it in the bulletin there at she's at Oakwood, and so if y'all want to send Lois a card, she'd love to hear from you. And I'm going to give her one of our books. By the way, you want to talk about joys? Is this new class not a joy?
Uh-huh.
On the Holy Spirit?
Yes.
I mean, and it's an excellent book. You don't need a dictionary to help you read it, you know.
Almost needed one.
Only a Greek
those
one.
Those words wouldn't have been in our dictionary, though.
No, they wouldn't. But if you happen to have a Greek dictionary, as I do, you know, but it was all Greek to me anyway. So, but folks, really, I think there might be a few of these left you can pick up. And we'd love to have y'all join us, because this is really a wonderful study on the Holy Spirit. So I encourage y'all to do that. I mentioned Carriage Hill erroneously when I was speaking Lois, but Leanne's grandmother did get moved into Carriage Hill last Saturday. She spent yesterday most of it in the ER there in Bedford, but they sent her back to her room. So continue to keep Leanne's grandmother's in your prayers. Leanne's with her this morning. That's why she's not here. Y'all did get enough of the flowers moved out of the way. She was having an allergic reaction to the flowers, about like at Easter with the lilies. So any other joys or concerns? Then let us bow our heads and lift up our hearts as we go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for all the blessings that you bestow upon us. The Bible tells us that all good gifts come from you. And Father, there's far more blessings than we could ever begin to inventory. Which is why there's a good saying, instead of counting sheep when you can't sleep, count your blessings instead. And all the blessings you've bestowed upon us here lately, Lord, it was truly a blessing to see the church filled with happy faces and celebrating the gift of love, a gift from you, celebrating two people who were strangers and you brought them together, and now you've blessed them to be husband and wife. Oh, what a blessing that was. And this beautiful weather that you've blessed us with this week, it's just been wonderful to be out in your creation and to see the beautiful transition from summer into autumn, and the beauty of the leaves beginning to change while there's still some green grass because of the rain that you sent us. Father, what a blessing to be out in your creation, because it reminds us to celebrate and worship the Creator. And for some reason, Father, we cannot fathom, you have chosen to present yourself to us as three persons in one, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And you have a relationship with us through each of these persons. So, Father, while we cannot grasp the mystery of the Trinity, we certainly can relish the relationship that we have with you as our Heavenly Father, our Lord and Savior, and as the Holy Spirit who empowers us to be the people that you created to be, people to be in relationship with you and in relationship with each other. So, Father, we pray you will bless this gathering here of your people, because we have gathered in your name, and your word promises that whenever two or more gather in your name, you are there in the midst of them. So we come humbly into your awesome presence this morning, praying you will bless the work that we do for you as we work for our community, be it locally, and the global community. Let us be about building your kingdom here on earth as it is in heaven. Hear us now as we pray the prayer that Christ taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Come on down. Good morning. How y'all doing today? I've got a question for you. In school, or maybe in sports or some other place, have they taught y'all CPR and mouth-to-mouth resuscitation? They have. Okay, good. So when you're doing mouth-to-mouth resuscitation, whose breath are you breathing into the body? Say again, please. Your own, absolutely. See, this ain't as difficult as you thought it was going to be, was it? You're breathing your own body into that person. Now, in doing so, you are resuscitating, right? Which is why it's called mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. Don't you like it when terms actually mean what they say? You're resuscitating the person, which means you're bringing them back to life. And your breath is doing that. In the Bible, it talks about when God first formed man from the dust of the earth, he breathed his breath into him, and the man became a living being. You see, God did not resuscitate Adam, but he gave him life. That lump of clay that was laying there on the ground did not become a living soul until God breathed his holy breath into him. Now, one interesting thing about that story is that in Hebrew and the Greek language, the word for breath is also the same word for spirit and for wind. So in essence, God breathed his Holy Spirit into that first human. And then they became a living soul. Can you see the importance of the Holy Spirit in our lives? That indeed, without the Holy Spirit, we may be walking around in these bodies, but we're more like zombies than we are really children of God. Because without the Holy Spirit, we aren't truly alive either. But praise be to God that we do have the Holy Spirit. Jesus promised his disciples before he left that God would send the Holy Spirit to them. And that the Holy Spirit would be with them and also in them. That means as followers of Jesus today, we not only have the Holy Spirit with us, we have the Holy Spirit in us. And the Holy Spirit gives real life to these mortal bodies in ways that most humans can't imagine because they don't have the Spirit in them. They're living only for themselves. But those who have the Spirit of God in them don't live for themselves any longer. They live to please God. And they please God by loving their neighbor as themselves. So will you bow your heads and pray with me? Repeat after me. Dear God,
thank you
for sending us your Son,
to be our Lord and Savior.
And thank you,
for sending us your Holy Spirit,
that it may indwell in us
and fill us
with your love
and your peace
and the power to worship you
and to serve you.
And it's in the holy name of Jesus that we humbly pray. Let all God's children say, amen. Now, we get to hear y'all sing, don't we? That's one of my favorite songs y'all going to sing. How's the arm? Let me go on this side and give you the hug. Good morning. How's it?
Sing until heavens ring, and I'm bidding.
Good job. Very good. Our Old Testament lesson this morning comes from Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 to 2, and then chapter 2, verses 4 to 7. When God began to create the heavens and the earth was complete chaos, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Remember, in Hebrew, the word wind also means spirit. In the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens, when no plant of the field was yet in the earth, and no vegetation of the field had yet sprung up, for the Lord God had not caused it to rain upon the earth, and there was no one to till the ground. But a stream would rise from the earth and water the whole face of the ground. Then the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being.
Our epistle text comes from Romans chapter 8, verses 5 through 11. For those who live according to the flesh set their mind on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to spirit set their mind on the things of the spirit. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the spirit is life and peace. For this reason, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh, you are in the spirit. Since the spirit of God dwells in you, anyone who does not have the spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, then the body is dead because of sin, but the spirit is life because of righteousness. If the spirit of him who raised Jesus from dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also through his spirit that dwells in you.
Thank you, Brian.
And our gospel lesson comes from the Gospel of John chapter 14, verses 15 to 17. And verses 25 to 26, and I'd ask you to stand as you're able for the reading of the gospel. Remember, Jesus is speaking to his disciples here. If you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him because he abides with you and he will be in you. I have said these things to you while I am still with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. This is the word of God for the people of God. You may be seated. So our sermon today is the Holy Spirit abides in us, abides with us and in us. Okay? The Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, abides with us and in us. Now, some folks might be asking, well, how can this be? That's the wrong question. The right question is, why is this? You see, there's no point in us spending too much gray matter, especially if you're like me, you don't have that much to begin with. Don't waste too much of that trying to figure out how God does it, when the really most important question is, why God does it? And the reason God does it is quite clear. His steadfast love endures forever. God made us for relationships. That's one of the things we're learning from our book, our study guide. God made us for relationships. The first relationship is with Him. Can you imagine this now? That the one who created all that exists, and just stop and think for a moment of the vastness of the universe. I mean, we've seen some of its beauty with the Aurora Borealis, right? Which if you can't understand that, let's just try saying the Northern Lights. And I know us folks down south don't like talk about the Northern Lights when there's plenty of lights down south. So we'll refer to the Aurora Borealis. But we've been able to see that. And in my goodness, if you get out of the urban areas and go out where there is no nights at light, you can actually still look in places and see the Milky Way. The vastness of space, all of the universe that God created. He spoke it all into existence. This is the God who desires a relationship with us. And it began when He formed us from the dust of the earth. As I've said before, and I'll remind you again, God was able to speak creation to existence. But He got His hands dirty when He made us. And He got so close that He was able to breathe His holy breath into us so that we became a living being. God desired a relationship with us so much that He made us in His holy image and He breathed His holy breath into us that we could have that relationship with Him. Now just think about that. That's more than amazing grace. That is truly astounding to the point where it's mind-blowing. And I said, don't think about the how because that's mind-boggling. God desires a relationship with us. And He made it possible that that could happen. But then sin entered the picture and destroyed that. It severed that relationship. It sullied us so that we no longer reflected God's image back to Him, nor to creation, as God had originally intended. But God's grace fixed that as well. First, He gave His Spirit that we became a living soul. And then He sent His Son, who could redeem us from a life of slavery to sin and death. And then be free to live the kind of life that God wants us to live, to be in relationship with Him. And so God then sent His Holy Spirit once again to fill us, to being the people He made us to be. Jesus promised His disciples before He left that God would send His Spirit to do exactly as I've just said, not only be with us, but to be in us, to dwell within us. You have the Holy Spirit within you to empower you to be what God made you to be. And that's why the Bible tells us, do not stifle the Spirit. That's what happened when the fall. They stifled the Spirit. But now that God has set us free from that, we need to live the life that God wants us to live. Paul was warning about that in the letter that he wrote to the churches in Rome. That if you're like most of the world, you're living for the here and now. And you're not even giving a thought to the hereafter. You're living to please yourself. You're focused strictly on the pleasures of the flesh. And we don't have enough time this morning to name them all, do we? But the folks that do that, they are not even thinking of God at all. They're living under what's known as prevenient grace. And I know y'all have heard this before because I've preached on it before. But I also know, because there's a lot of former teachers here, that one of the ways we learn is through repetition, right? Boy, they drill that into me in the Army. So I'm going to give you another little reminder of solid Wesleyan doctrine and on three types of grace: prevenient grace, justifying grace, and sanctifying grace. That word prevenient is not in our lexicon. We might need a dictionary to look at it too, right? But you do know what convenient is, don't you? In fact, we have convenient stores. That something is convenient when you know you need it, it's there. Something is prevenient when it's there before you know you need it. Think about that. It's there before you know you need it, before you're even aware of it. God's grace, His prevenient grace, is free to the whole world. It comes completely with no strings attached. There are no conditions about it. It's universal and free, and most people don't even know about it because they're living for the flesh. When folks are living under prevenient grace, they are alive to sin and dead to God. They don't even know God exists because sin reigns in their life. But God remains wooing us to Him. Even though we're alive to sin and all we care about is what pleases us, God remains wooing us to turn from a life of sin and turn to Him. The Bible says, resist the devil and he will resist you. Turn near to God and God will draw near to you. God's prevenient grace enables that to happen. And when we do finally see that our life is not what it ought to be, and that God will enable us to live the kind of life we should, that's when we fall under justifying grace. Justification is when you recognize that you are a sinner, but you have a God who loves you and a God who forgives you, and that you have a right relationship with the God who made all of that exist, not because you've suddenly become so good, but you recognize the sacrifice that God made on your behalf by sending His Son to set us right with God. When you come under justifying grace, you realize that God is alive. There is a real God who wants a real relationship with you. And so now you no longer want to live to please yourself. You want to please God. So God now reigns in your life. But sin remains, still trying to tempt you away from God and back to a life for the world. So justification alone is not going to save you. Even though with justifying grace, you've got a relationship with God. But that sin remains. And by the way, justifying grace, unlike prevenient grace, comes with one condition and one condition alone. It must be received in faith. God is not going to ram it down your throat. He's not going to hold you by the nose and force feed it. No, you have to receive His grace in faith. Remember, the Bible says, for it is by grace you have been saved through faith, not your own works, so that no one can boast. So, since justifying grace is not enough to save us, we need a third level of grace, which is called sanctifying grace. Sanctifying grace, like justifying grace, is free to everyone, but it has the same condition. It must be received through faith. And unlike justifying grace, which is instantaneous, sanctifying grace requires a lifetime of going on to perfection. But under sanctifying grace, God reigns in your life and sin no longer remains, because you have become dead to sin and alive to God. And that's what Paul is talking about in the passage that Brian read earlier. That to be under sanctifying grace, you've become dead to the flesh. Sin no longer has any part in your life. You are alive to God. He says, if the Spirit of the one who raised Christ. And who was the one who raised Christ? God. If the Spirit of the one who raised Christ is in you, then the God who gave life and rose Christ will give life to your mortal bodies also. That doesn't mean when you die. You see, everlasting life does not begin when we die. It begins when we truly accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior. Because as he described the existence before that, even though we are mortals and alive, we're more like zombies, the walking dead. Because God really isn't in our hearts. And so all we care about is the life in this world, and all of that, brothers and sisters, is not going to last forever. There is nothing everlasting about our mortal life, which is why Paul writes in another letter in Corinthians that this mortal body must put on immortality. This perishable body that we have must put on imperishability. Then is when the scriptures come true, and the song that says, where, O death, is thy sting? Where, O death, is thy victory? You see, the sting of death is sin. But praise be to God who gives us the victory through Jesus Christ. And most of the world is now walking around focused strictly on what pleases them. They're not giving a thought to God whatsoever. But as I said, that's prevenient grace, where sin reigns, but God remains. But let me tell you, when you truly do accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, then God truly will give life to these mortal bodies. Jesus says, anyone who wants to save their life, this earthly life that we have, anyone who wants to save their life will lose it. For whoever tries will lose their life for my sake, and the sake of the gospel will find their life. You see, we were made for relationships, not a life where we are the center of the universe and everything revolves around us. We were made for relationships with God and each other. And until we can realize that we are no longer the number one, and the world tells us, you're number one, right? If we're all number one, then how does that arithmetic add up? If we're all number one and we're all looking out for number one, how many folks are looking out for you? One. But when we surrender that and become a child of God, we cannot begin to imagine how many folks are looking out for us, because we're all looking out for each other rather than ourselves. And if you're only living for yourself, you really aren't living. And if you try to save that life, you're going to lose it. And I'm here to tell you, that is true for us as individuals, And that is also true for us as a church. Yes. If a church is only concerned about saving themselves and maintaining whatever type of life they've had collectively as a church, then they're going to lose that life eventually. But the church that is willing to give up that life for Christ and for the sake of the gospel, that's the church that's really going to find itself, what real life is about. Because real life is about relationships with God and with each other. That's why the two greatest commandments is to first love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. And the second is to do what? Love your neighbor as yourself. That's what life is all about. That's what really is living. And brothers and sisters, this is what Christ has promised when he said that the Holy Spirit will be with you and in you. As we continue our study of the Holy Spirit, we will learn more about the Holy Spirit, and we will also learn more about ourselves. We will learn about the work of the Holy Spirit, and we will also learn about the work that God has in store for us. Yeah, God has work planned for us. That should not surprise us. Because when he first created humans, he put them to work, looking after creation. He gave Adam naming rights to all the animals, right? God still has work for us to do today. But we have to get past that mindset that thinks that we're number one and the universe revolves around us, and realize, no, the one who created it all is number one. And it really moves about him. But praise be to him. He has a place for each and every one of us. And he is the one who's made that possible. By his grace, prevenient, justifying, and sanctifying. By God's grace, we have a relationship with him and each other so we can be truly alive even in these mortal bodies. And then when these mortal bodies no longer exist, then we have the promise of a resurrected body. Soul and body will be together for all eternity. So brothers and sisters, accept the promise. Accept Christ in your life so that you can truly live to the glory of God and our neighbor's good. Will you please stand, and we will affirm our faith with the Nicene Creed, which is number 880 in the back of your hymnal. You'll notice that's quite a bit longer than the Apostles' Creed, and we talked about that in class. So if you want to know more about that, come to class. Together, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We'll now sing the Gloria Patri as the offerings are being brought forward. Now let us pray our prayer of thanksgiving together. Gracious God, you are our provider and sustainer. As we offer you these tithes and offerings, remind us of the call to let go of our earthly attachments and follow you wholeheartedly. Bless these gifts and use them to further your kingdom on earth so that all may experience your grace and love. May our giving reflect our trust in you and our commitment to serve you as we minister to others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Closing hymn this morning is number 714, I Know Whom I Have Believed.
Thank you.
Brothers and sisters, we are saved by grace, through faith, for good works. So go forth, doing the good works that God has set you free to do. Go forth with His Spirit being with you and in you. Go with God's love, His peace, His joy, and His blessing. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.